Good morning. Morning. How is everybody? Y'all good? Turn to the person beside you right now and say, you look good. You look good. Some of y'all feel like you're lying. I'm just kidding. Don't raise your hand. Do not raise your hand. That wouldn't be good. It wouldn't be a good church moment, would it? Man, we're glad you're here. We've been thinking about this New Year's resolution thing. We started last week. And we've been kind of thinking through, you know, whether or not we should make New Year's resolutions, really which just focus on us. Resolutions are all about making a sweeter, faster, better, you know, looking version of me. Or whether we should push it a little bit further, a little bit deeper to ask a broader question. And the broader question really would focus on not just how do I make things better for me, but how do I make things better for the world that I live in? And so this is a series more about creating a revolution than it is about making resolutions. Now, I thought I should have done this last week, and I actually thought about it, but I didn't have enough time. So I thought it probably would be really good if I were just to find the word revolution. So I did that. I went to Wikipedia, you know it, because if it's on Wikipedia, you know it's law, you know it's true. And so here, according to Wikipedia, a revolution is a fundamental change in political power or organizational structures that takes place in a relatively short period of time when the population rises up in revolt. Anybody rebellious in the crowd? You already think, I like this. I like this, yeah. Rises up in revolt against the current authorities. Well, let me make sure that I'm clear what we're talking about. We're not talking about a political revolt, or we're not trying to overthrow the government. Maybe. No, I'm just kidding. Actually, the word revolution actually comes from a Latin word that means this. It just simply means to turn around, and that's what we're talking about. So what if this year, and instead of trying to turn things around for me, you know, what if we went broader and deeper than that, and we said, you know what, I want to turn things around for my neighbor. What if a husband said, I want to look at his wife and said, you know what, I want to turn things around for you this year. What if a wives were looking at their husbands and they say, you know what, I want to turn things around for you this year. What if we as families just looked at each other and said, you know what, I mean, I know that the world is big and there's a lot of needs in the world, but what if we just started here at home? And then what if you looked at your neighbors? What if you looked at the lady that you work with, the guy that you go to school with? What if you looked at the cashier at Bilo? And what if you just were to begin to think, what if I focused my time on making the world a better place for them? And it's not that making, you know, resolutions are necessarily a bad thing. It's not that, you know, focusing on eating healthier is a bad idea. It's not. You know, I think that there's probably some of us this year, because I've looked around, that, you know, it would probably be good if we went on a diet. You know what I'm talking about? Lose a few holiday pounds. That's not a bad thing. It's not a bad thing to start to think about how to get out of debt, you know? The debt that I've been in has been weighing me down for way too long, causing too much stress in my life. It's not a bad thing to begin to think about you, but I think there's a bigger, broader question. And here's really what I'm going to push into today. There's a bigger purpose for living than just us living for us. It's bigger than that. There's a more life-given purpose than just focusing on us. Last week, we looked at this passage from Nehemiah. And if you remember Nehemiah chapter 1, Nehemiah gets broke, and he gets broke emotionally, right? And it's kind of weird that if you look at Nehemiah's story, and if you've never really done that, you need to go back and maybe listen to last week, or you just need to read the book of Nehemiah for yourself and to do a little digging, do a little study. And what's really weird, and when you look at this, is that he's broken over a place that he's never been. And he's broken over a people that probably he doesn't know personally. Now, he knows that these are my people, you know. He knows that he has this sweet Jewish heritage. And he can be broken over that, but it's more than that for him. He's broken over a city that he's probably never visited. And it was an emotional thing for him. He said that when I heard the news about the destruction of the walls in Jerusalem, I sat down and wept. I mean, this thing broke my heart, and I mourned, and I fasted, and I prayed for days. And his countenance was so bad that he couldn't help himself. He literally went to the king and said, you know what? I need an extended leave from my really cushy, sweet, sweet job. I mean, I'm cupbearer to the king. I mean, he tasted wine all day, every day. Hello? How many of you would say, you know what? Sounds like a pretty good gig to me. And he left that. He left all of that to go to a place. He was a cupbearer. We don't know that he was a builder. It was an emotional thing. And then it pushes us to this question that we ended up with last week. And the question is this: what breaks your heart? What breaks your heart? As you look around at your family, as you look around at your community, as you look around our city, as you look around our state, as you look around our country, let me just ask you, what is it that breaks your heart? And there are a lot of needs out there. I mean, there are tons and tons and tons of needs out there, and you may not be able to meet every person's need, but I tell you what you can do. You can't change the world, but you can change the world for one person. And I'm back to 25 days of Christmas. Hello, I'm still in December. Are y'all with me? I mean, I still go back to that, and I remember what it was like on those days when we were there, and I thought, you know what? This is not a big deal to some of us, but it's a very big deal to these people. That day was a life-changing experience for them. You know what I'm saying? We couldn't buy everybody's groceries at Bilo that day. We couldn't pay everybody's electric bill that day. But I tell you what we could do. We could step into that one person's world, and we could make a difference. So as you look around at all the needs around you, in your home, your community, in your school, whatever it might be, what is the one thing? Or what is the one group of people? What is that one maybe group of people that you just find yourself kind of leaning in their direction? And there's a lot of things that come on TV every day. And maybe, you know, or maybe even you've heard us talk about some of the missions and some of the things that we're involved in here. And you think, wow, I really, you know, gain is such a sweet thing. I'm glad that we house homeless people in this church. But some of you have never really been moved to serve in Gain. You've never taken an opportunity to get to know some folks that are homeless, and you've never brought a meal. You've never hung out with them. You know what I'm saying? And it's not that you're a bad person. You just kind of looked at it, but it didn't move you to action. So what's that people group? What's that one thing that when you hear about, you sit back and you think, you know what? Something ought to be done about that. And maybe for you, if you've kind of thought about that one thing, that one people group, that one whatever event, that one whatever it is, as you've kind of thought about that, you know what? You've even found yourself on the internet doing a search, trying to gather some information. I wonder if there's anybody out there doing anything about this. I'm just asking, what breaks your heart? And it can be an uncomfortable question, can't it? I mean, listen, I'm up here and I can almost sense the uncomfortableness that it kind of puts us in. So you mean you want to push me to actually do something? No, I don't. But I know that Jesus will. And I think that you have to consider the next question. Because there's going to be a sacrifice. I mean, I'm just telling you, it's going to cost you some time. Could even cost you some money. But I know there's going to be a sacrifice. And so here's the question that we're going to ask. The question that we're going to ask is it worth it? I mean, really, is it worth it? Is it worth it for me to maybe take a little bit of my focus off of me and to put it on that people group, that group of people, whatever that group of people might be, or that particular need in the world? I mean, is it really at the end, is it gonna pay off? Is giving my life away to something or someone else, is it worth it? And I believe that Jesus answered that question. Jesus was, when you walk with him through the Gospels, Jesus was constantly surrounded by crowds. and he was surrounded by crowds of sick, smelly people. Lepers, people oozing sores. People literally that were nasty. People, the kind of people that, in fact, when some people would walk by, if you were a leper, unclean. You don't want to get near those people. And those people wanted to be near Jesus. And everywhere it's kind of like a zombie movie, you know. And everywhere that Jesus went, these people wanted to be near him. And you know what they wanted to do? They wanted to touch him. There was this one lady, and the scripture says that she had an issue of blood. She had this disease, and she couldn't get any better, and they'd probably prayed, and she had begged and pleaded with God to heal her, and nothing would really happen. And you know what she felt like? She said, you know what? He doesn't have to see me or speak to me. There is something so incredible about this man that if I could just get close enough, you know, just to touch the hem of his garment. I mean, shoot, I don't even have to, like, have bodily contact. If I can just touch the hem of his garment, there's something about this man. And that was the life of Jesus. Everywhere he went, there were these huge crowds that gathered around him. And you know why? Because everywhere Jesus went, he just made life better for other people. He just did. He fed them when they were hungry. Could you imagine being there that day? Like 10, 15,000 people, and he takes a few sardines and a few saltine crackers, and he blesses them, and there were baskets of food left over, you know, and he feeds thousands and thousands of people. Don't you know that story got out? And he said, man, you won't believe this. I was there, like, I was super hungry. I got to be honest, I don't even know what he was preaching about. I mean, I got hungry, you know what I'm saying? I mean, you people wouldn't be that way, but the next crowd will kind of get that way a little bit. I can kind of tell. You know, we kind of come into the end. They want to say, land the plane, preacher. You know, land the plane. Get on the runway so we can get out of here and go eat. So can you imagine what people were saying about him? Because everywhere he went, every time he got close to someone, their life got better. So he couldn't escape the crowds. Maybe this is why he spent a lot of time down by the Sea of Galilee. You know, his best option to escape was just to get in a boat and go. So in the book of Luke, we're told that large crowds were following Jesus. Hundreds of people were traveling with him. And then Luke says that he turns to this crowd. Chapter 14, verse 26. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life. And it amazes me there's nothing mentioned about mother-in-laws here. That's the thing. It's always, that was free. It didn't cost you anything. It's not even in my notes. Such a person cannot be my disciple. And if you're new to Christianity, and this is what I, you know, this is why I love hanging out with folks that are kind of new. Because if you're new to Christianity, you'll probably look at this and go, whoa, dude, hang on just a minute. We got a problem. There's a huge problem. Now, some of you that have been in church your whole life, you know what? You just read this passage, you don't think anything about it. Some of you that have really struggled with your faith, and we all, at some point, will come to a crisis of belief when we won't be sure about what we believe anymore. Then you'll read this passage and you'll go, wait a minute, you know what? You're right. Because I've been taught my whole life that God is love. That's what John said. You know, John said, God is love. And where is the love in this? I mean, what's up with this? He's telling people literally to hate? Well, it's hyperbole. It's an exaggeration. How do I know that? I'll tell you how I know that. Because that's not what Jesus taught. In fact, in John 13, verse 34, he said, a new commandment I give you, love one another. And it's really not a new commandment at all. The God of the Old Testament and the God of the New Testament is the same God. And it's the same incredible God of love and mercy and forgiveness. Nothing's really changed. But Jesus certainly displays the love of God. It's a picture of the love of God. He says, I love one another. And don't just love one another as I have loved you. As I have loved you, so must you love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Are you getting the point? I think he's kind of nailing this thing that he's not talking about hate. So what is he talking about? He's talking about who's in control. That's what he's getting down to in this passage. This is Jesus' kind of big, bold way of saying, look, I know that you've been following me everywhere I go. And I get that. And I know why. Because you heard that I healed the lame guy, and you heard that the blind can see. And you heard that I could raise people from the dead. I mean, you heard about me feeding the multitudes. And so everywhere that Jesus went, people crowded around him. And Jesus said, you know what? I completely get that. But here's the thing. You can't be my disciple. You can't be one of my followers until you decide once for all who's going to be in control. Who's going to be master? Who's going to be Lord of your life? You've got to decide who's going to call the shots. Who is it that has the ultimate say in your life? It's hyperbole. And did you notice? Did you notice that he said, yes, even your own life? Sounds kind of harsh. And again, this doesn't sound like something that a loving, compassionate, tender Savior would say, but that's exactly what he says. He says to hate your own life is really to decide once and for all who's going to call the shots in your life. Is it going to be you or is it going to be me? And this is where we feel the tension. Because if you don't feel any tension right now, you should. I feel the tension. Because here's where we begin to feel the tension that Jesus creates in whether or not I'm going to make my life sweeter, better, faster. Am I going to make a better version of me? Or whether or not I'm going to create a revolution by making the world a better place for others. And this is going to be a really hard statement. And I'm telling you, you have no idea how many times I would go back and I'd look at this next statement. I'm going to read it to you because I don't want to mess it up. And I would almost change it. And I would think, I'm not sure. It's too early in the message. I don't know. Lord, do you really want me to say this now? And he said, yes. I said, okay. The essence of following Jesus is self-denial, not self-improvement. And that's not what I was taught. Now, nobody stood that I can remember. I don't remember a pastor actually standing up on a Sunday morning and saying that verbatim. I don't remember them saying, the essence of the Christian life is self-improvement. But that's what I heard. And again, it's probably not their fault. It's just what I heard. Because all I knew that to be a Christian meant that you don't smoke, drink, or cuss anymore. Why are y'all looking at me like that? Am I the only one? That's what I thought. I didn't know any better. And then I got a little older, and then if you really, really love Jesus, you won't have sex before you get married. And then once you get married, you won't have sex outside of marriage. And really, when it came down to it, that's really about all I knew. And so all I thought that what all God really cares about is self-improvement, behavior modification. And then suddenly, years later, when I'm in the gospel, I go, wait a minute. The emphasis is not on self-improvement. Some of you are going to walk out here and say, he said that we could do anything we wanted to do and it was okay. That's not what I'm saying. Now, I'm not saying that holiness doesn't matter. It's not what I'm saying. But what I'm saying is if that's all you focus on, you missed it. You missed it. Jesus would say, I'm not against self-improvement any more than I'm against you loving your mama and your daddy and your children and your husband and your wife. I'm not against any of those people. I'm not against any of those relationships. I'm for those relationships. I'm not against you being the best that you can possibly be, but here's what I'm saying is that for once and all, you're going to have to decide who's going to call the shots. So you just can't follow me and decide that someone else is going to be the shot caller in your life, whether it be your mama or your daddy or your wife or your children. And hello, have you seen parents today that are controlled by their children? Don't you, in the name of Jesus, just want to slap them sometimes? I mean, we mean that in love, right? This is all Christian right now. Are you with me? Don't you want to just jerk him up and say, he's not cute. She's not sweet. She's irritating. Right? You've had those moments. And so they call the shots. And Jesus says, listen, who's going to call the shots in your life? I just lost all the parents. And if you think that sounds hard, it gets worse. Whoever does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. And these people would have went, that's death. When you say cross, listen, that was not a pretty way to die. it's not like a lethal injection. And I'm not saying I'm ready to die, but if I got a chance between the cross, a cross, being nailed on a cross, or a lethal injection, I'm taking the lethal injection. And when he said that, these people, they would have gasped. They would have went, death on a, pick up the cross? This is crazy talk. Here's what I thought. Here's what I thought when I read this passage. I thought, well, this is not a really good church growth strategy at all. I mean, Jesus, you hadn't read the books. You know what I'm saying? I mean, like, where's the hook? You know, where's the hook to get everybody back next week? I mean, Jesus, do you understand this is not a crowd building statement? This is a crowd thinning statement. So in essence, he says, you know what? You can meet my traveling buddy. That's okay. You can eat my free food. I'll heal you and your mama, your mama's mama. But you're not my disciple until you decide to come and die to yourself. You can't, I mean, you can travel with me, but you won't be a sincere follower of mine until you are willing to die to yourself. On another occasion, he says something very similar. Mark's gospel, Mark chapter 8, verse 34. Then he called to the crowd to him along with his disciples and said, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. And then he goes even further, and I think it's to the real heart of our struggle. He said, for whoever wants to save his life, and you would stop right there and say, well, of course we want to save our lives. Of course we do. Absolutely. I spend a lot of money on trying to improve and to save my life and to give me a better quality of life and to try to keep me alive, right? It costs money to be healthy. Hello? That's why I'm fat. I'm fat because I'm just cheap. I can't believe I said that. And somebody said, amen. That's what I don't get. Have you ever tried to eat organic? How many people have tried to eat organic? It's just a banana for Pete's sake. You know, an apple. And you don't want to eat it. You want to put it on the counter and take pictures of it. Because, I mean, that thing is like, it's golden delicious, all right. I mean, you know what I'm saying? So it takes a lot of money for me to put into me in order for me to be healthy. Of course, we want to save our own life. But Jesus says, whoever wants to save their life, whoever wants to save their life will lose it. So Jesus says that whoever lives every day of their lives with the it's all about me mentality, with the I'll do whatever it takes to preserve me mentality, here's what he says. If you live your whole life that way, the thing of it is you're going to lose life. You're going to lose it. And he doesn't even stop there. And you're thinking, wow, what a day to go to church. Couldn't have been John 3:16. You know, it's got to be this kind of stuff. But whoever loses their life for me and the gospel will save it. I'll tell you what I've learned about this passage. This is not just like it's going to happen to you. You're not just like going to wake up one day. And I've heard people talk about the discipleship process, you know, and we start following Jesus and we get closer and we get closer and we get closer. I'll tell you what I've learned. You will never get to this place if you're just going to wake up one day and realize that you've died to yourself. I'm going to tell you what's going to happen is that you're going to realize that there has to be a decision on your part. And you're going to be confronted with decision. I promise you it will be almost every day. It will at least be every week. That you will be confronted, am I going to say yes to me, or am I going to die to me, and am I going to follow Jesus? And here's what else I want you to hear, because I know some spiritual zealots out there, and this is not about throwing your life away. It's not about dying to yourself to make a point. And I think that for Christians, for way too long, we've made way too many points. Does that make you make sense? Probably doesn't. I'll explain that on another day. It's not a call to throw our lives away. It's not a call to irresponsibility. That's not it. It's a decision. It's just simply a decision to say, Jesus, I am willing to allow you to lead me outside of me for something bigger and better than me. That's it. It's a call for us to give our lives away. It's a call to a revolution. It's a call to a revolt against the norm. It's a call to go against just me being self-serving and only caring about me. It's a call for me to look around and to say, what people group, what person, what situation, what is there that I can give my life to? And I can't make the world better for everybody. I can't make the whole world better, but I can make that person's world better. And I may not be able to fix it for a lifetime, but I can make it better for today. And so if you decide to wrestle with the question, what breaks my heart, it will ultimately lead you away from you. And so suddenly it's just not about self-improvement anymore. And at some point, again, I wish I could just dress this up. We need a song. Don't we? We need a song right now, don't we? We need some kind of sweet music playing in the background because this is just hard. At some point, it's going to lead you to a place of self-denial. It's going to lead you to a point when you're going to say, you know what, I could spend this $10 on me and get me a coffee at Starbucks, you know, or I could take this $10. Which is it going to be? Is it going to be for me or is it going to be for somebody else? At some point, I believe with every fiber of my being that God will bring us to a point when we will have to decide, is this going to be for me or is this going to be for somebody else? And there's nothing wrong with getting a coffee at Starbucks. I had one this morning. It was great. Jesus says this. This is the essence of what he's saying. He said, if you live for you at the end of your life, it's a total loss because you will have nothing to show for you but you. That's why I love following Jesus. That's why I love the Christian life. Because it's an invitation to significance. It's an invitation to step outside of yourself. It's an invitation in the selfish, self-centered world that we live in to be unique. It's an invitation to move into a direction that most people are afraid to move in. It's about living life with a purpose. Here's what everybody discovers at some point in their life. Everybody asks this question. And some of you are here today because you've been asking this question. You've literally said, probably out loud, is this it? I mean, is this it? Is this life? And you know what? You whatever it is, whatever that thing that you were pursuing, that ideal weight, you know, whatever that thing that you were pursuing, have you ever just got there and then you got there and you stood and you looked in the mirror and you thought, man, I thought this was going to be so much more fulfilling than this. I thought that this was going to be my answer. And then you're saying, is this it? And the answer to that question, if it's all about you, if it's always been all about you, the answer to that question is going to be no, it's not. You can be the most self-improved person on planet Earth and still be empty. But you can give yourself away and be full. It doesn't make any sense. Jesus said, if you empty yourself of yourself, you'll be full. Because I've created you for a purpose that's bigger than you. You're not enough. You're just not enough. You're not enough to give your life to. So is giving your life away worth it? Yes. And I'm looking around this room this morning and I'm thinking, if some of you, you know that's true. You know it's true. That's why you serve. That's why you do. That's why you give. You don't give your money because we stand up here and present it in such a way that it's so compelling that you'll dig down and to say, oh, gee, 10%, are you kidding me? The way David said that today, I think I'll do 15. Has that ever happened? If it has, let me know. We'll get him back up here every week saying the same thing over and over again. That stuff like that doesn't work, does it? It doesn't. Because even in your giving, if your giving was all about making you feel better, you know what? It won't be enough. It'll never be enough. I probably shouldn't have said that last part. So it gets us back to the question, what breaks your heart? What's the need? What's the group? What's the challenge? What's the issues that grips your heart? What is it that breaks your heart? And then here's another question I think that kind of helps narrow it down, that you can kind of help narrow that thing, narrow this thing down, is who's doing something about it? In other words, just do a little research. Because whatever it is that's breaking your heart is breaking somebody else's heart as well. And sometimes they've already laid a tremendous amount of groundwork. That's one of the things that we've done at this church. There's some things that we do that we just came up with all on our own. One loaf, we didn't get that from anybody. We just that was birthed right here within this church. But there are other things like GAIN. We partner with an organization who's already doing it. And there were already 12 other churches, and we partner with them. And then we know that as we partner with this organization, that there's going to be every single week that homeless people have a safe place to go, and they're going to be fed. And that's what we did. We said, who else is doing something about it? And then we just joined them and say, let's just do this thing together. And then you have to make the sacrifice to make it happen. To make the world a better place at some point, you're going to have to say no to you. And so that's what Jesus meant when he said, deny yourself. Say no to you so that you can say yes to something bigger and broader. And we believe, as followers of Jesus, that when you do, that when you engage in the needs of others, listen, we are never more like Jesus. We are never more like Jesus than when we're serving others. And I think that he loves it when we get together on Sunday. But getting together on Sunday should be a pep rally. You know, getting together on Sunday should be us coming together, and we ought to be able to share with one another. I mean, God, let me tell you what happened this week. There was this guy at work. There was this lady. Let me tell you, I was at Walmart, and God spoke to me. It was crazy. I mean, I was right there in the fruits and vegetable aisle, and he spoke to me and said, there's that lady. I want you to buy her groceries. It'll be crazy stuff. And we'll get to share that kind of stuff with each other, and we'll go, wow, you know, I don't know if I can change the hungry, the homeless plight for everybody in Greenville County, but I could put a dent in it for that one lady that one day. And we're never more like Jesus. We're never more like Jesus than when we're just serving people and loving them. God looked at this world that was broken by sin, and it broke his heart. And his broken heart compelled him to send his one and only son into this world to wade in neck deep into your sin and mine, to bear the burden for our sin. So if you're here this morning, you're not a follower of Jesus. God brought you here just today, just for today, just for this message. Because some of you realize, you know what? You're exactly right. I don't understand everything there is in the Bible, but you know what? You spoke truth this morning, because I've given my life to me, and I'm more self-improved than I've ever been. But you know what? I'm still empty on the inside, and it's because you've been filling yourself with the wrong thing. You're just not enough. And maybe you've tried self-improvement, and you said, I'm just going to get better, but you know what? You've realized that no matter how good you are, it's never good enough. You've already drawn that conclusion. You said, man, I try to get better. I try to do better. I try to be better. I'm trying to be a better husband, a better wife, a better child. I'm trying to be a better parent, but no matter how hard I try, I still miserably fail. And you've just come in this morning just with brokenness. And here's what I want you to know, is that Jesus is absolutely crazy about you. And what he desires is a relationship. Don't get caught up with, I'm going to give my life to Jesus, and he's going to use me to change the world. He doesn't need us. He created the world without our help. figure that. I don't know how he did it. Do you? Like, he didn't have any committees. He didn't get a Baptist committee together and say, boys, what do y'all think we should do about light? How bright should it shine? What color should the grass be? We didn't have to vote on that. He doesn't need us, but he wants us. And that's what's crazy. He wants us. And what he wants is a relationship with you. And then through you, we will just love others. Don't you get it now? See, is it making sense? Then we'll just love others. And it'll be that love that will draw people to him. So maybe you're here this morning, you say, you know what, Scott, you're right. I'm empty on the inside. I need Jesus. If that's you, then every head is bowed and every eye is closed. Maybe you're not a follower of Jesus this morning, but you'd like to be. So if you're ready to surrender your life to Jesus, maybe right there in your seat. Maybe you just pray a really simple prayer. And it would go something like this. Jesus, I'm empty. I want to be filled, not with me, because I know I'm not enough. I'm not enough for me. And I want to be filled with you. So I know I'm a sinner. I'm confessing that to you. I'm confessing to you that I need forgiveness. And I'm telling you that my desire is to walk with you for the rest of my life. Fill me with your Spirit so I can serve you. And so I can just love others the way you've loved me. You are amazing. Lord, we love you. Lord, there is something very unique and beautiful that's been happening in this place. I don't know how many times I've said that, Lord. How many times over the years I've just felt that wow, that you're here, that you're using this church to make a difference in the community. Lord, I know that our best days are ahead, and Lord, all we want to do is we just want to serve you. And Lord, we know that we'll serve you and we'll love you by just loving each other, taking care of each other, and reaching out into a world that just needs to see love demonstrated, not just words. Then they'll believe us when we share the words, when we're able to say, no, we're going to act first. Lord, there are broken people in this world, broken, broken people. There are people, groups that are broken and have been pushed away from the church. Lord, could you help us to love them and embrace them? Doing the best that we can to just lead them to you. God, not trying to fix them. I can't fix me. But that we learn how to say no to ourselves and to allow more of you into our lives. And that's where the healing power comes from. Lord, we love you. And it's in your sweet name that we pray. Amen. Hey, if you made a decision today, if you just accepted Christ today, if you'd fill out that card, that would be great. And then if you'll just give it to one of our greeters as you leave, that would be wonderful. There'll be some folks down here with me, and if you'd like to hang out and chat a little bit about this whole Jesus thing and how to do it better, can I challenge you this with this as well? We're going to go into a fast in just a couple of weeks. We'll only be drinking water for 21 days. I just wanted to get your attention. What? You'll think, I ain't coming that series. I don't know when are we starting that one. You know, I won't come back. Just relax. But here's what I want us to do as we begin to even think and prepare for this series is, what is it that God is stirring in our hearts? I do believe that this is a church that can make a difference in our community. I think that honestly we've only begun to scratch the surface. So if you have some ideas from time to time, I'd love to just hear what you got to say. Love you. Have a great day. Bye.